BBC News headlines at 11 here on BBC Two. First, another hard talk.
Welcome to Hard Talk. I'm Stephen Sacker. Early in his writing career, my guest today was pigeonholed as the enfant terrible of the British literary world. Four decades on, Martin Amis remains one of the most successful and closely scrutinized novelists of his generation. Much of his fiction fizzes with dark energy. In Amis's world, greed, lust, addiction, and ignorance loom large. And yet he insists he writes in a celebratory spirit. So what exactly is he celebrating? Martin Amis, welcome to Hard Talk.
Thank you.
Your latest novel is called Lionel Asbo. It's a sort of satire on a State of England novel, but nobody could read it, I think, and conclude that you believe that England today is a healthy society.
One wouldn't write a sort of satirical novel claiming that, and I think... I don't think anyone believes that everything's going fine. I think there are some fascinating contradictions in British society. I think it's historically explicable, but this huge interest in the trivial and
celebrity and a sort of shallow culture.
Surfaces, appearances. And I can only think that this is what happens to a one-time great power when it ceases to be that, and where what it does no longer reverberates in the world as it once did. And I think we got through that demotion because the ideology was saying that we don't like empire. If anything, we're ashamed of ever having had one. So we made the switch, but subconsciously, I think it's in people's, you know, subliminal minds.
Do you care about the state of England?
Yeah.
Personally?
Yes, very much. I have three children on this side of the Atlantic who live in London.
We should make it plain that you, for the last couple of years or so, have been living in New York. Some saw the book as a sort of middle finger salute as you left England.
We knew that would happen, and my wife and I, and it was just unfortunate timing, really, because I was...
So there wasn't any element of that?
No, none, because I'd almost finished the book by the time we left. It was conceived and certainly first draft done long before we even mentioned moving to America. And then as I was on my way out, so to speak, every chance I got, every public appearance, every sort of interview, I said, it's nothing to do with disaffection with England. And it still came out that way, you know, a vicious V sign from the airport. and it never was that.
I take that point, but nonetheless, you've talked about, you know, characterizing the shallowness, the sort of surface nature of current English society and culture, but doesn't it go beyond that? I mean, there is something truly depressing about the dominance of casual violence, of greed, of pornography, a sort of corrosiveness that invades every corner of the London that you portray?
But it's written with affection, and in fact I think that...
Affection for what, though?
For England, for the English. It's what I miss most in America is the Americans are just as tolerant and generous as I think, you know, most English people are, British people, by which I mean anyone who's chosen to enter into the spirit of life in our beyond our shores. But they don't have the wit. Americans aren't witty, because it's that kind of society. If it's an immigrant society, then you're very sensitive about giving offense. And a joke, after all, is always an assertion of superiority.
But if I might just pursue that line for a minute, a joke is an assertion of superiority. Isn't there a sense in which you're asserting a sense of superiority over your characters? So many of your characters are drawn from, you could loosely say, the working class or even the underclass. And they are predominantly men, not all, but predominantly men who, coming back to this point about venality, greed, lust, violence, they are unpleasant characters in so many different ways. And are you not, you know, as a man from a comfortable background, looking at the working class and condescending to them?
Well, that's my right to address the residuum, as it used to be called, the underclass. Was questioned for the first time in my life with this book, and I've been doing it for 40 years, writing about that class. In fact, the absentees in my novels are the middle classes. I take the extremes at the top and at the bottom, and the middle class is well served by any number of novelists, but they don't interest me.
But is the working class well served by you?
Yeah, I should think so. I mean,
but don't you laugh at them?
Yes, but I also exhort them. Don't forget that the other main character in the book is an angelic creature who is
Des, you mean?
Yeah,
young
superior,
Des.
Superior to me morally and in decency and all the rest, and thirst for education, and writing a novel is sometimes very crude business. If Lionel has to be that bad, then Desmond has to be that good. And that's how novels are put together.
Do you care how your novels are received anymore? I mean, you've written 13 of them. You've bust your guts to get these books out. Does it matter to you how they are received?
Well, that's all you have, really. I mean, writers go on about reviews because it's all they have. They have letters from readers, but you are slightly dependent on that.
They haven't been good, have they?
No.
They haven't been good for Lionel Asbo, and to be honest, they haven't been that great for a number of your later novels.
No, that's not the case. The Pregnant Widow got good reviews, and House of Meetings before that got even better reviews. But I occupy this peculiar position in England. People think they can be, there's no limit to how offensive they can be when they write about me.
Why do you think, I mean, I know what you mean, because I've looked at some reviews for some of the books, and I think probably you'd agree maybe the worst were for Yellow Dogs.
Yeah.
And some of those were so brutal, I was sitting there thinking, well, when Martin Amis read this, what must he have thought? I mean, particularly, you know, from fellow novelists like Tibor Fischer, just so downright damning of you and the book.
Yeah. Well, I think it's partly to do with my father. When I started out, it was not a disadvantage to be the son of a writer. If anything, it was an advantage. Then heredity, the whole question of heredity, swiveled, and it became a taint.
Do you think so?
Yes, I do. And it's I lack legitimacy for this reason, it seems, that the lingering notion is that I inherited a full set of writer's genes, and it hasn't been difficult for me, or I don't have the usual pains that, you know, all writers have. But there's sort of no upper limit to how offensive people are. And with Yellow Dog, it wasn't just reviews. Anyone who could hold a pen was queuing up. So it was a sort of Paul Johnson wrote about it and said it was one of those little episodes of militant anti-intellectualism.
How thick-skinned do you think you are?
Well, being the son of a writer helps, because I'd seen my father, you know, get a battering every now and then. It makes you a bit more detached from the whole business.
See, what strikes me is that you've always, sometimes in this chair I slip into sounding like a pop psychiatrist or something. I don't mean to do that, but you've always had a complicated relationship with the media, for example. I mean, you've been a journalist. You've spent a lot of your sort of spare time from novels actually writing journalism and travelling the world for newspapers. You've also sort of lived a pretty public life, and at times you've appeared to quite enjoy the limelight and being in the press and on TV. And yet at the same time, you seem to deeply resent a lot of the journalistic coverage of you.
I sometimes satirise the press in Yellow Dog and again in Lionel Asbo. Mm. And that is absolutely forbidden. Because, and they're right in a way, they think they made you. So you're being an ingrate if you complain about the press, because the literary novel was quite an obscure activity until about 1980, when the media just got so fat that it had to start including literary writers, because they'd run out of rapists and boxers and ne'er-do-well royals and depressed comedians, reduced to writing about us.
But it's a sort of Faustian bargain, isn't it? I mean, I just wonder whether you reflect now and you look at perhaps the decisions taken by other top writers around the world. I'm thinking people like J.M. Coetzee and maybe Don DeLillo and Thomas Pynchon and others who've very much kept their distance from the media and living any of their life in public. And they've just said, look, judge me on the novels and nothing else. And you've never done that.
No, I haven't. I enjoy the interaction. And writing is tremendously solitary. And you have to have a huge appetite for solitude. And you have, in a way, have to be most alive when alone. Mm. But
you get bored.
No, you don't get bored, but it's just a change. It's a dramatic change from your average days and weeks.
Let me ask you about freedom, because I'm very struck. You've written quite a lot about how important writing as an expression of freedom is to you. Writing is freedom, you said. That's why it's such an agony to contemplate the fates of writers who are trying to write in unfree societies. I'm just intrigued to wonder how you've responded in the last few days to the mountain of new evidence that seems to be gathering that the place you live right now, and indeed your homeland in the United Kingdom, are places where, unbeknownst to us, a lot of our communications, our telephone calls, our internet and electronic digital communications, are in one way or another being marked, monitored, and stored in vast intelligence-gathering machines. Does that worry you?
Yes, it does. And it's, you know, you can't but be passionately pro-Obama when you see who he's up against in the last election, for instance. But he's perpetrated quite a few things semi on the sly that that are much resented, and this is certainly one of them. And it'd be interesting to see if he has to backtrack now, or he's brazen it out.
I'd just like to think again in an international perspective. I'm very interested to see that Ai Weiwei, the Chinese artist, who's of course had huge problems in his own country, said he was shocked that the United States is doing this. He said the US appears to be acting like China. And again, with this thought about freedom and what America symbolizes and represents to those not living in America, I just wonder if this is changing things.
Well, I don't see how it cannot do how it can do otherwise. One almost feels it as a violation, and a clear abuse of power.
Now, another area which perhaps is linked to this, because no doubt one of the motivations for the new reach of the intelligence services in the last few years is the post 9/11 concern about the threat from Islamic militants, something you have written about and thought about and responded to. And indeed, not so very long ago, about 7 years ago, you responded in a very passionate way to revelations about a particular plot to blow up airliners. You remember?
Yeah,
over the skies of the Atlantic. And you at that point said, and you were thinking aloud, you said, you know, this prompts an urge to see the Muslim community suffer until it gets its own house in order.
Yeah. The journalist who'd come to see me had flown across the Atlantic without a book, like everyone else on that flight. And this incensed me. It seemed a victory for ignorance and incuriosity.
But didn't it also just seem like an overreaction from the security people on the ground?
Yes,
you know, it's this idea about fear and getting the balance right between security and basic freedoms, and whether once you fall into a fearful mindset, then the danger is you get that balance wrong.
And you say things as foolish as what I said. It was a sort, I didn't recommend this course of action, but I floated it. And it is a pernicious thing to say, because collective punishment is always a bad idea. It's malum per se. And that I ceased to believe that later on that afternoon. I had a chat with a friend, and he said, "Oh, yeah, but if you do that, you turn them all against us." And I thought, "Oh, yeah." But I was sort of in a funk. It was the first time where I thought, maybe they are stronger than us.
What you have said since is that you are not Islamophobic, but you concede that you could be Islamist. Phobic.
Yeah, better say takfirophobic. Takfir is a Islamic heresy or sophistry whereby you justify killing not only others but your co-religionists by the following means. If they're good Muslims, they'll go to heaven. If they're bad Muslims, then to hell with them. And that is what Islam calls people like Osama bin Laden, takfiri. And I'm certainly against that.
But where does that leave your... Because I know you look at events in the Middle East and you write about them. Indeed, you wrote a book, The Second Plane, I think, what, about 5 years ago, which looked at the post-9/11 world. So given your concerns, when you look at a country like Tunisia, which is now governed by an Ennahda, which is a party which is Islamist, or indeed the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, or indeed maybe even Turkey with Mr. Erdogan, do you conclude that these governments are a long-term danger to your values in the West?
No, I don't think the governments are, but it's all... The Arab Spring is already looking like the Arab winter, and it's not at all surprising that democracy has not taken hold in the way we all hoped it would. That it is a foreign idea and would take decades, if not centuries, to become the norm in the Arab world. I don't fear the governments, even if they are Muslim Brotherhood. It's the individual. And the recent outrages we've had, the Boston bombing, for instance, and the Woolwich stabbing, seem to me to come under the heading of what John Gray has called anomic terrorism, where it's actually alienation that makes you act. And you tart it up with a few slogans from, that you've learned online that make it look as though you're protesting against the invasion of Iraq.
Before we end, I want to come back to your creative writing, your fiction. I know you're working on a new novel about Auschwitz, the Holocaust, which is a subject you've visited before. As you go through the creative process now, does it get harder?
Well, it does and it doesn't. What falls off is that flowing inspiration you had when you were younger.
Kazuo Ishiguro, I know you've discussed this with him. He once said, look, frankly, most of the great books are written by people under 40.
Yeah.
And presumably he thinks that's not an accident, and maybe you agree with him, I don't know.
Well, you do lose that flow, but you gain in technique. You know more firmly what goes where, and modulation, and how to tell a story. You're perhaps a less good novelist, but a better storyteller.
But do you struggle to find new things to say, and new subjects? I mean, you've done the Holocaust, but I mean, I know this is a facile thing to say in a way, but you've sort of done a Holocaust book. You could argue Lionel Asbo raised lots of issues that you've looked at in other sort of state of England novels. Are you running out of ideas?
It's not about ideas. It's the way a novel comes to you is in the form of a sort of frisson, what Nabokov called a throb. The first throb of Lolita went through me when. And it's a very pleasant visitation, and what appeals to you about the idea or this Don A is that you can write a novel about it, and then the novel mysteriously accumulates and seems to be to pre-exist, and you just have to gather it up.
So when you said not so long ago, I've gotten myself into a paranoid funk about how the talent dies before the body, you're looking ahead a bit.
I am. No, writers die twice to make up for the otherwise very pleasant life of dreaming up, of using your imagination. But this didn't come up before. Dickens died at 59, Shakespeare at 57, Jane Austen at 43, and as for the Bronte, the younger sisters, 30. But now Herman Wouk is 97 and completing a novel.
Well, what you seem to be sure about is that in your lifetime you cannot expect to be judged fairly about the quality of your work, because you say, what really matters is if you're being read in 50 years' time.
Yeah.
And do you think you will be in 50 years' time?
Well, that's why my eyes light up when I see young readers at signings and readings. When I see 25-year-olds who, have my books, and I think, well, that's 50 years there and then. You realize that all the reviewing and even lit crit is most of it is just rhetoric. There is no way of separating the excellent from the less excellent. The only thing that does that is time. And you won't be around for that, as my father used to complain. There's no use to him, posterity. But I think that was just bravado. We all want to live on. That's partly why we have children. The desire for some kind of immortality is a very deep drive.
And, in your case, it's the children and the books.
Yes, as a way of continuing.
Martin Amis, we have to end there, but thank you very much for being on our talk.
Thank you.
Thank you.